So the topic today is strains and sprains, orthopedic overexertion injury prevention in your company. So we have customers from all walks of life at MEM. We have 15,000 customers from municipalities to fire departments to ambulances to entire hospital systems to home health to heavy manufacturing to light manufacturing to construction, all types of construction, bricklaying, excavation. So what we're going to do is talk about strain, sprain, orthopedic, overexertion, injury prevention broadly. We're going to talk about lots of different ways, lots of different strategies to help do that. So that's what we're going to chat about today. Like I said, the chat function is open. I'm taking a look at it. If you have questions through this, you do not hesitate to reach out. Also, if you have comments, check out our podcast. Did you know MEM has a podcast? We have a really great podcast. It's called the WorkSAFE Podcast. And I've identified four podcasts that will help you through your efforts to help prevent orthopedic injuries and then manage those claims better. Okay. So there's four podcasts out there that we encourage you to take a look at. We've got a really cool podcast channel. Okay. Here we go. It's 12:08. 8 minutes of Mark talking. We're going to get a whole hour of this. So put your seatbelt on. Get ready for this. So I'm asking you, have we thought about 2022 yet? And have we put a plan in place? Do you know what you're going to talk about? And then when we do those safety meetings and when we meet with employees, is it focused really on driving down losses? So I'm asking you to look at 2022 and work on effective plans to really drive down those losses. And we'll talk a little bit more about that. And our focus with orthopedic injury prevention and overexertions and strains, sprains, and those things, this is where safety people have to expand their reach. We don't just talk about what is happening at work, because orthopedics is health. So we're also talking about our employees and our health. Do they go get physicals? Do we promote healthy lifestyles? Do we have a health and wellness program? Do we talk about our EAP program? Do we talk about our smoking cessation programs? I don't know. What other things are out there that we can offer to help people be stronger, more flexible, more resilient to injury, right? To preventing injuries. And then also safety at home. Absenteeism hurts our organization pretty bad. So when somebody's hurt at home, it hurts us at work. So yeah, we should be talking about things like strain, sprain, slip, fall, safety awareness, even in our homes. A lot of us do a lot of different types of stuff when we're off work. Some of your folks use chainsaws. Some of your folks use ladders. We have a lot of folks hanging Christmas lights right now, hanging all over the place off of ladders. So that's kind of how we want to broaden our reach and broaden our message, that we care about you all the time, not just when you're at work. And what is this a photo of? This is a screenshot. Can anybody in the chat function tell me what this screenshot is? I pulled the screenshot. This is the obesity. This is the color-coded chart for the percentages of obese people in different states. And the obesity epidemic is really a problem. Epidemic's really a problem for us in the United States. We've just got to talk more about health and be healthier ourselves, because it's very difficult to stay safe on difficult walking surfaces, difficult working surfaces, difficult working conditions, challenging working conditions if I have very poor health, right? So we've got to focus on health and wellness, flexibility, strength as part of an overall injury prevention program. We're talking diabetes, hypertension, stroke risk, okay? And all of the things associated with that. So just some thoughts there as well. The CDC webpage can give you way more information on that. So 2022 is here. Flint and I, a lot of us were talking about the fact that, you know, we have Thanksgiving coming up and Christmas coming up, and then the new year. our safety plan should be in place now for 2022 to drive down injuries. So what is your plan for reviewing safety rules with your employees? And one question I'll have for you, this is something for folks to just chew on. Are safety rules in your organization really meant to be followed? Meaning, is your safety plan just something that we have around, but folks just kind of do whatever they want anyway, and we'll deal with the problem when it becomes a problem? Or is it something that is zero tolerance? And I'm asking you that. How effective is your safety plan, and do people ever follow it? So our friends that are in municipalities or different construction companies, that kind of thing, when you have a seatbelt policy, do people actually follow it? Is there a focus, theme, or goal? Meaning, we've had a few orthopedic injuries this year, so we're gonna try to really work those down in 2022. Orthopedic injuries, slip, fall, vehicle crashes. What are your current insurance costs, and what claims have you had? So, as part of an orthopedic injury prevention program, I want you to go back and look at where you have had incidents in the past. Maybe in plant one you haven't had any, but plant two you've had three or four. Maybe we focus on plant two then. Insurance costs and claims, all lines. Maybe we've had some fleet incidents that didn't necessarily involve work comp, but they did damage a vehicle. Well, let's talk about that, because that we're concerned about that and safety as well. Strategic plan for reducing injuries and costs. What could your lowest experience rating be? Maybe you're at a 1.01 right now, but you really could be at a 0.69. That's the strategic goal. We're going to talk more about the experience rating. Near miss reporting is big. We've chatted about that before, and what can be done differently in order to improve. So that's kind of what we're talking about for 2022. And I'm challenging you to really think about these things. Now, keep in mind, everybody's going to get a copy of this PowerPoint. So MEM will send this out to everybody. And another thing to think about too, if you ever need this kind of PowerPoint developed, for you, or you need some of this kind of content, let me know. I've in 15 years created thousands of PowerPoints. I can help you out. So don't hesitate to reach out. So the purpose of the safety program, and we will get to strange sprains, but we're going to kind of build up to that. We're looking at activities that you do that reduce losses. Now, in workers' compensation, that's a term that we kick around. Flint, we all talk about losses. Losses is a sort of a slang term that means, one, the acute injury occurred in the first place. So we had an employee that cut their finger, right? They cut their finger and needed to seek treatment. That's the acute injury. Loss also includes the financial component. So we had not only the loss with the acute injury, but we had the finance along with that. So the employee had to go out for MRIs, surgery, had tendon repair, and final settlement, and maybe a couple of days of lost time, right? So that's loss, the acute injury and finances, okay? So we're trying to reduce those incidents, loss improvement. But your safety program also does what they call risk improvement. We may have not had any vehicle crashes in the last few years, but we know we have that risk. I have 34 vehicles, and they're outrun all over central Missouri, but we haven't had any losses, but we have the risk. So that's something else we want to talk about. Now, with orthopedic injury prevention, you may not have losses, but you always have the risk. Write that down. You always have the risk in every type of work being done. Your office help can lift boxes of printer paper. Your office help can go get supplies and bottles of water. Your office help types and works at their desk. Your warehouse work, they lift and move heavy stuff. Your construction crews lift and move heavy stuff. We always at all times have risk of orthopedic injuries anytime you have employees moving around or doing work. Another risk that you will always have is slip, trip, fall. It is very difficult for me to control slip, trip, fall when you have an inherent risk, which is gravity. I can have the most perfect slip resistant floor out here, and an employee could easily trip over their own feet. hit the ground. So I think about these things. Vehicle crash. You may have not had any crack ups with your own vehicle, but I guarantee you've had near misses. I guarantee you've had, you have the risk. You'll always have that risk. So in the safety plan, think about risk. Also think about key exposures. What do we do? What are our primary hazards? And are we dealing with them? So we don't look just at compliance, DOT, OSHA, et cetera. We look at all injury prevention best practices. We combine them with compliance. Yeah, we need compliance, but that's not it. So you, as a manager of a safety plan, are also looking at two things. What can we do to reduce injuries? And these things are outside of compliance. Drug-free workplaces are not required by OSHA. A written seatbelt policy is actually not required by DOT. You have to wear your seatbelt, but the policy is not required. So we look at best practices, also compliance, combining them, and the results are going to be reduced losses, reduced risk, reduced cost, and improved business productivity. Because we don't have these boat anchors dragging us down. So those are some thoughts with regard to what we're doing. Every job has orthopedic injury risk. So make sure all of your crews, all of your work areas are having that discussion. What is most likely to happen there? What can happen? Are we addressing heavy lifting ergonomics at desks and workstations and things of that nature? So let's think about that. It's not just construction crews, primarily is, but also remember our folks in the office as well. Let's keep moving. Our bodies do it all. Our back does everything. Our knees hold the weight. Our shoulders bear the weight. Our body bears the weight, and it does it for years. In the chat function, if you think about this, how many machines do we have? Our cars and our driveways and our lawnmowers and the machines that we have and operate, how many of them will last as long as the human body does? Our human body is very resilient. The bones and joints and connective tissues and muscles. Goodness, we work a long time before it starts to break down, but what breaks us down is sheer weight, moving and yanking around on things and pulling heavy objects, and we just abuse ourselves. One of the things we have to think about here, and I'm going to type this in the chat function, is abuse. In what ways do our employees abuse their bodies doing their work? Lifting extremely heavy loads. Trying to get work done. Pulling, pushing extremely heavy objects. And we will put ourselves at risk all the time, okay, while we're doing this stuff. So just think about that. Let's get out there and look and see what our people are doing that is just too much. And what can we do to make that job a little safer and a little bit better for them, right? So how do we see people overworking, overusing their bodies in awkward postures, heavy lifting, that kind of thing? And in construction, heavy lifting, it is what it is. We do so much. So what I'm thinking here is, yes, do we have to lift heavy things and move and push and shove and hoist? Yes, we do those things. But have we trained our people to actually use machines? And have we trained our people to use those machines and go get those machines and take the extra time to rig it up and use cranes and buckets and boom lifts and that kind of thing and forklifts? And then also put it in a safety rule. What safety rules do you have that address ortho injuries and risks? A lot of us just go on hope. Well, it's construction. Construction's hard. They lift and move heavy things all the time. It's hard. That's just, it is what it is. And we tell everybody to watch their back, but when we're out on the streets, nobody actually really does it. So let's put that into some safety rules, right? We'll talk more about that. Some concerns. Overexertion, too much force. NIOSH says that we shouldn't lift anything over 51 pounds. And all the home health folks and all the hospital folks laugh when we say that. Every patient we lift, every patient we move, it's just too heavy, right? Overexertion. So force, repetition, awkward postures, poor housekeeping, meaning our feet can't move, our feet can't support the weight. Slips and trips, where we don't necessarily fall, but we incur a strain or sprain because our body jerked or moved in an awkward posture. Falls with outstretched arms, we have outstretched arms, arm incidents where we have rotator cuff tears, and those are significant injuries. And then things like meniscus tears, knee injuries, ankle injuries, just moving and doing work. So things to think about. At MEM, we are a broken record. I'm going to tell you that. You know this. We talk about the same thing all the time because these don't change. You've got to write this down. These don't change. In your organization, you have these risks. You may have not had losses, but you always have the risk for these things. Slips, trips, and falls are always going to be an issue. Flint talked about them last month. You will always have this risk, so we need to always address it. We're coming into winter, so we used to say that anytime we had a snowstorm that came through Missouri, we would have $1 million in losses, $1 million in employee injuries every time it snowed. That's the truth. So we're always going to have that risk. We will always have overexertion injuries. So number two, there, overexertion injuries, back, shoulders, ankles, those kind of things. Always talk about this with employees. Always talk about this. Always talk about personal health, flexibility, strength. Always talk about the safety rules that are associated with safe lifting, what you have in place. And always go out and see what people are doing. Do job site inspections, do job site audits, and do their job. If you're seeing a particular part of a warehouse that is having back injuries, go do the job and see what they're dealing with so you can relate. You're always going to have vehicle crash risk. So we really want to make sure that everybody is following the buckle up, phone down philosophy. Follow the speed limit, wear seatbelts, don't drive distracted, don't drive after consuming alcohol or illegal drugs, right? And then struck by, caught in between. Anytime man works with machine, we have pinched fingers, you know, things that we drop on, toes, right? Struck by, caught in between, hazardous contact type of injuries to hands, toes, feet, eyes, those kind of things, right? So these are some things to think about. We will always talk about this. In 2022, we will talk about these. We will continue to talk about claims management. There's a lot that we'll always talk about in MEM because this is how it always happens, right? This is what happens. And then the hierarchy of controls. In safety, this is something we always talk about. So with orthopedic injury prevention, what engineering can we do to remove the hazard or minimize the risk or make some changes to move things around? Okay, so folks don't have to deal with it. Then you have policy, which is basically things like job rotation. Well, in job rotation where we move, we only allow you to do that job for 2 hours, and then we move you to another job, do that 2 hours. All that is using different muscle groups and reducing the risk with time. That's a policy thing. The hazard's still there. We've just moved you and brought in somebody else. This hazard is still there. Safety rules, adapting people to the hazard. The hazard's still there. We're just trying to adapt you to it through policy. Follow these rules. And then personal protective equipment. Once again, the hazard's still there. We're adapting you to it. So that's a hierarchy of controls. Number one, engineering is very important. What lifts, what carts, what machines can we put in place so your body is not used as a machine? Go back to this, these photos up here. Your body used as a machine and it will wear out. We're very resilient. Grow old, we're in our 80s, you know, we're still moving around doing our thing. These things do wear us out. So body used as a machine, what tools can be brought in to remove that? Our guy there in the middle with the jackhammer, they actually put jackhammers, breakers on the end of mini excavators, and you can do that without even touch. You can break parking lot concrete all day long with a breaker on the end of a jackhammer. A breaker on the end of a mini excavator all day long. And you don't even have to hold a jackhammer anymore. Same way with the saw there. Can we lift that up so we don't have so much weight on the lumbar spine, on the spine? Same way with our gentleman there running the chainsaw. What can we do to raise all of that up? So that's engineering controls. Love engineering controls. Moving ahead. We're always going to talk about these things. That's our loss improvement and risk improvement emphasis, which is motor vehicle, struck or injured by, strain or injured by, and fall, slip, trip. Now look here. In 2021, 23%, one out of every four calls is an orthopedic injury. So go back and look at your losses. Go back and look at what your folks do. And just realize that risk is there. It's always going to be there. We need to talk about it. We need to continually analyze jobs. We need to continually analyze for improvements we can make, equipment that we can get in there to help, to help with those jobs. And we have got to focus more on personal health, flexibility, personal health, strength. 33% of all of our claims so far this year have been slip, trip, fall. One out of every three calls is a slip, trip, fall. So, and I'll tell you, there's the money, being perfectly open and honest with you right now. As of this morning, we've spent $80 million on employee injuries at MEM in 2021. We spent $141 million last year. There is a lot of money at stake. So we've got to work harder at this. So that's what I'm asking you to do in 2022. This year, when you look at our claims, we have the majority of our injury reports are report only, then followed by medical only. But these orthopedic injuries tend to end up or can end up as lost time incidents. So we will talk briefly about claims management of these as well. So far this year, as of this morning, we've had 8,436 injury reports reported to MEM. This year, we have had as high as 16,896 injuries reported to MEM. So whatever we can do to reduce this number, it makes things so much easier on our customers. It gets your costs down and makes you more productive. So let's talk about this. Orthopedic injury prevention. I want you to think about your policies and procedures and what you have in place. Now, orthopedic injuries, we're talking about back injuries, shoulders, knees, ankles, hip, lumbar spine, thoracic spine. What makes these injuries worse from a management standpoint, from a confusion standpoint, from a the employee gets an attorney, that kind of thing, is one, lack of timely reporting. I'm going to put in the chat function, please contact MEM immediately after any employee injury. Okay, and within 24 hours, please do that. Late reporting is a huge problem. Okay, just simply submit a report only and then call us if you need to escalate it. Now, people ask me, Mark, do I have to report an injury, this particular injury to MEM? I can't answer that. What I tell people is anytime an employee is bodily or physically injured at work, submit a report-only claim and then call us if it needs to escalate. Lack of investigation, orthopedic injuries, did it happen at home? I don't know. Did anybody investigate it? One thing I do mention is how many injuries are in the work comp system that do not need to be in the work comp system, but they were never investigated, and we were basically handed poor information, and now it is a compensable claim. How many are compensable injuries that didn't need to be because there was nothing to defend? No drug-free workplace program. Are you comfortable with fully paying a work comp claim when the employee tests positive for methamphetamine? You have rights as a Missouri employer to have a drug-free workplace, and then MEM will support that by seeking penalties when employees don't follow your drug-free workplace policy, test positive, and have been injured. No written safety rules. With orthopedic injury prevention, I want you to specifically list safety rules. We'll talk more about this with regard to how people work around these machines, these supplies, these heavy, awkward tasks. No directed medical care. So if an orthopedic injury were to occur, employees just pretty much go wherever they want. We really want them to be seen by an orthopedic specialist that's skilled in work-related incidents. No timely return to work. So the employee really needs to be offered light duty, but we don't. So now we have no idea what they're doing. Light duty really helps relieve a lot of problems. David, I saw your chat there, and absolutely. I'll email you the slides, David. Don't let me forget. Text me or email me. I need to chat with you anyway, too, David. So let's chat after this. So no proof of safety enforcement. That is critical. And then lack of a plan when employees perceive that you have a disorganized injury management plan. The single most common reason why an employee would seek representation during an injury is because they feel that they're not being communicated with and not being told they feel like they're not being told the entire story. That's an easy one. We can deal with that. Communicate with the carrier and communicate with the employees. Let's keep moving. That's our 10 most common problems we see with worker injury claims that escalate. So my recommendations for everybody: have a plan and be organized. Know that we have risk for orthopedic injury and we need to have a plan to get that treated. We take an injury today. Today is not the day to try to figure out who a good workplace physician would be. Go ahead and use the CorVel website. Identify CorVel partner physicians skilled in workers' compensation and have that plan in place. Be organized. Provide work comp training to all supervisors and management. That way, if an employee comes into the manager's office, the manager has a basic idea of how this needs to be handled. A big problem is when an employee lets you know or lets your manager know that there's been an injury, but the manager forgets about it or doesn't think it's that big a deal and doesn't get it reported. The employee says, I told management they didn't do anything. Perform orthopedic injury prevention safety meetings all the time, and inspections of work areas. In hospitals, we see slide boards all the time hanging on walls, in emergency room slide boards. And then you look over here and you see an ambulance crew transferring a patient from the cot to the hospital bed and they don't use it. Well, why? Put it in a safety rule that says you are required to use slide boards. Enforce the use of these tools. Make sure the use of these safety devices is written into safety plans, safety rules. Take each injury report seriously and report it at minimum as a report only at MEM within 24 hours of the report. Please do that. Direct medical care, specializing in workplace incidents. Investigate everything. Okay, written statements, written witness statements, written supervisor statements, and then go out and see what we can do to make to prevent it from happening in the future. Post-op for drug and alcohol screening, light duty. I'm going to type this in the chat function. If you keep a claim med only, you will receive a 70% reduction in how the claims dollars are calculated in the experience rating by NCCI. Med only claims are huge in reducing experience ratings, but also duty is huge for getting people back to work. And then monitor and communicate with us. Each claim has an effect on the experience rating. $150,000 shoulder rupture will add over 3 years, $70,000 to the premium. So for us to just say, oh, well, we have insurance, the insurance will take care of it. Yeah, well, I mean, we're going to help with that. But, you know, just realize that these injuries and the injury costs affect the experience rating significantly at times. And realize, and as part of your to-do list with regard to 2022, what is your current experience rating? Is it going to go up? Have you talked to your agent lately? Is the experience rating going to go up? And then how many orthopedic injuries affected the experience rating? Remember, if you're over one, you're paying more for workers' compensation than you should, than suggested retail price. We want you under one. We want you to save money. This particular policyholder has a $244,000 current premium at a 1.16 experience rating. At a 1.0, they're at 211, but their minimum mod, their strategic goal is 0.59, which means they are leaving $120,000 on the table each year and 57 points on their experience rating. How many of you would love to have $120,000 back in your budget? Safety will help do that. So let's keep moving. With regard to orthopedic injury prevention and your safety plan, look at your past EMOD rates. If they really haven't changed, then I'm sorry, but your safety plan is ineffective. How you manage claims and your safety plan is ineffective. Something is wrong, and I need you to look at that. What have your experience ratings been? Or you look at the column on the right, 2017 through 2021, they went from a 1.31 down to a 0.81 in 5 years. That is effective. What are they doing right? But effective is what we're talking about. I don't want to just see a safety plan. I want to see reduced injuries. If we have an injury, or, you know, injuries, your current EMOD rate is based on injuries that happened 3 years ago, 2 years ago. What does that mean? This year, policy year, and last policy year aren't calculated. It's the three prior. But what does that mean? If we have an injury today, it won't get calculated in the EMOD rate this year. It's not going to get calculated in the next policy year. It will hit in the next 3 years. So there's a, if you have an injury today, it will not go off until 26 or 27 that policy year. That's wild. So every day really does matter. So messaging, inspections, making improvements, right? Talking about health, talking about safety at home, orthopedic injury prevention, talking to our folks all the time about it. Random thoughts. We need to be healthier and more flexible. That's just a fact. The CDC shows us every year. They talk about the obesity epidemic and in our health. They call them what, the lifestyle diseases. We need to address these. Post-offer employment testing. Check out our website and learn more about how we've partnered with WorkSTEPS and Select Physical Therapy. You can, between the job offer and when the employee starts work, send prospective employees to be physically evaluated by Select Physical Therapy, and they'll tell us whether or not the employee is physically capable of doing the job safely. Post-offer employment testing. Check out our website. We highly recommend it. What if the employee has past injuries? You'll never know, but with post-offer employment testing, you will. Can the employee physically do the job safely? Post-offer employment testing will tell us. It is really a very effective way at making sure that your new hires can do the job and that you're not hiring your next work comp claim. Workplace health and wellness programs need to be promoted more. Smoking cessation, regular work audits. What do people do? Are you going out there to work with them and learning what they do? Heavy, repetitive, strenuous work that will lead to a breakdown of people's bodies and to injury. Disc degeneration, disc displacement, sciatica, things of that nature, right? Shoulder rotator cuff tears. Investments in material handling devices, development and training, and specific work procedures. But my opinion is your chair is the enemy. We have got to get out there more with people. We've got to see what people do. What are your past loss trends? Are your folks mounting and dismounting trucks or equipment? Are they lifting and moving things regularly? Material handling, assembly processes, construction jobs, hand assembly, mechanics. Everything a mechanic does is an awkward posture. Patient handling and healthcare. There is no safe way to move people. We need that extra gear and equipment. And then types of products moved. What are they moving? A moving and storage company lifts hideaway beds, hideaway couches all the time. Very heavy. This particular picture, there's nothing wrong here. It's a gentleman doing work, one of our policyholders. It's kind of a photo we took 10 or so years ago, but the reason why we took the photo is cramped workspace. The forklift is parked too close. There's no room for him to move his feet, and the boxes are still wrapped with shrink wrap, and the pallet should actually be removed from under the pallet rack to get access. Jerking, yanking, pulling on products or components, outstretched arms, which means our backs and our shoulders are at risk. Leverage in safety is bad, because leverage, especially in orthopedics, means that we're going to take out a joint or connective tissue. We need safety expectations for each job. Moving ahead, obstructions, lighting, hasty work. Actually doing a job in an unsafe method, in an unsafe way, and consciously knowing that we're doing it. No specific processes, no specific training. And folks just want to get it done. Mentally, they just want to get the work done. And I get that. Here's an example of, you know, a car wreck with one of our customers, the fire department that we work with closely. You know, nothing wrong here. There's no unsafe issue. They're trying to help get somebody out of a car wreck. But with regard to orthopedic injuries, you can see there the strain on the backs and lifting, but also the work area around their feet is an issue, because now I can't really move. So it's very difficult to adjust. We need somebody in there to help move some of that around for them. So those are some examples. Equipment in trucks. Clutter is definitely a safety issue. There are so many heavy things that our folks have to lift and move. Falling objects that you try to control, like these ramps on this trailer, are extremely heavy. I say ask your people. They may have some improvements that they can recommend. They do the job every day. We don't. This particular fire truck had rescue tools that were pretty much just thrown in a compartment, and the city's mechanic is a really great fabricator, and he took the truck into the shop and in about 4 hours had a really nice rack system built for the tools. So those are very heavy rescue tools, but now they're way more accessible and easier for folks to use. So we like that. Talk to your mechanic, talk to your fabricators. How can we put tools away better and store them better to get access better, right? Things like this. This is where I like to use machinery. Heavy buckets, heavy things. What machines can we use? Our housekeeping is critical. Housekeeping is critical in order to be able to reach and grab things without falling and tripping over things, resulting in that orthopedic injury. Housekeeping is absolutely critical around super heavy things. And if you notice that rack there, that shelf, things stored up high, how do we get them down? Well, it's abusing our bodies, and we lift them and we put our shoulders at risk. Trucks, storage in trucks? Is it organized? It's one example. So moving ahead, it's 12:48. Questions for you. When was the last time your written safety expectations were reviewed and signed by employees? And do any of those reference orthopedic injury prevention, specific processes for doing things? In healthcare, we require slide boards. Okay. For example, when was the last documented safety meeting your employees attended? And are those safety meetings having any impact on losses? We've had 8 injuries a year for the last 8 years, and we do safety meetings every month. Well, that means something's wrong. Nothing's changed. So we're not doing safety meetings just to do safety meetings. We're just doing safety meetings to discuss very specifically what we need. Do your safety meetings reference the safety plan? Now, I have seen this. Safety meetings that do not discuss specifics in the safety plan. Always make sure your safety plan is brought to the safety meetings and given to your employees. Okay. And that we talk directly out of that safety manual. Do we do corrective action? Yeah, you could say disciplinary action, whatever you want, but when employees don't use things like slide boards, or they don't use dollies, or they don't use two-wheel carts, or they don't use the right equipment that you bought, spent a lot of money on, when they don't use it, what happens? And then do we actually go out to make work inspections? Now, we don't in safety do enough inspections. We don't. We do paperwork and we're worried about compliance. We sit at our desk and shuffle things. We've got to get out there better with the people to learn what they need. What do they need? Do we ask them that? Work inspections. And just more backup on safety rules and the offense. I'm not going to go into this too much further, but are our safety efforts actually affecting losses, or are we just doing them just to do them? Are we addressing top types of injuries in our industry? Slip, trip, fall. In fire departments, we have a trend of training incidents, injuries occurring in training. Okay. In healthcare, in a hospital setting, it's patient transfer, falls in the restroom, things of that nature, right? What is specific to your industry? When were your policies read and signed by employees last? Another observation is I don't believe annually is enough. I think when we're having injuries, annually is not enough. I can't remember what I signed last year. Let's be honest. So let's get the safety plan out there more with people. Have we enforced safety rules lately? Is documented corrective action performed? Have work areas been inspected? Are new hires being addressed? Post-offer employment testing, please research that. We can help you through that. Have you reached every safety employee with a safety message, and are employees recognized for when they do safe work? Just had a discussion with a customer that's going to be saving quite a bit of money in the next policy year. The experience rating went from 1.04 to 0.94. And that's going to be about a $12,000 savings for this customer. So they are going to do the simplest and most effective incentive program ever. They're going to buy a pocket full of $10 quick trip gift cards. And whenever they witness an employee doing the job right, they'll actually give them a $10 gift card and say thank you. So that's really neat. That's a simple way of doing it. And with orthopedic injury prevention, when people are using the equipment, when you see them doing this work, talk to them about it. It's one of the biggest risks that we have. Some of these injury claims can be quite complex and require complex surgeries. So if we can get folks to do this work safely and actually use that equipment, hey, maybe it is worth the $10 gift card. Macro and micro, let's talk about this safety strategy. And then we're going to work on wrapping up. We have the overall company safety plan, but then you have your department safety plan. So with a municipality, I have the overall city safety plan, but then I have water department, street department, parks department, police department, fire department. They have their safety plans. But then you have micro safety rules, which address specific tool usage. Right? Specific tool usage. For example, your company, your people have to lift generators. And they have to leave generators behind at job sites chained up so they're not stolen, right? So we have generators. Everybody has generators. In an effort to prevent orthopedic injuries, all generators, no matter their size, must be lifted to and from trucks and trailers using excavators, cranes, or supplemental lifting devices. Do not manually lift generators. That's what we're talking about. Get more of that in place. If you have an ambulance service and you're lifting oxygen tanks to and from the ambulance, you put this rule in place and say you will always use the bottle lift device. Never lift by hand. So that's what we're talking about with the micro safety rules that are very important. We have these really neat cranes and Tommy lifts, but we also need to reflect the use of this in a safety rule. Okay, that you're going to use this stuff to lift generators, pumps, supplies, buckets of materials, that it will be used. So I like these machines, but anytime you have safety equipment, you reflect it in a safety rule. Okay. Moving ahead, return on investment is something else we could do better at. If you need assistance with return on investment training, that is going to be a topic that we'll talk about in 2022, but we will be talking about return on investment. When you buy equipment, how does it return the cash and reduce losses and save your company money? We may spend $20,000, but you may save $60,000 over a couple of years when your incidents go way down, right? Return on investment's huge. Random thoughts, housekeeping, rough terrain, everything is heavy, yanking, wrestling on with everything, using forklifts, machines, that kind of thing. Get creative. Employ stretching programs, hydration, smoking cessation. Why don't employees use the safety gear that they are provided? Okay, moving ahead. With regard to post-offer employment screening, we have a success story on the website with Schatz Underground of Villa Ridge. Dave Schatz, his company, great customers of MEM, they use post-offer employment screening. You can see how it has helped that company. You can contact us. You can contact Select SSM, and we can get you fixed up with that program. But it's a key to making sure folks are physically capable of doing the work. Put this picture in here, a skid steer, because you know what? We need to train people to use this kind of machinery to lift these things. And I say, you know what? If they're going to use the forklift to lift a 5-gallon bucket of paint, so be it. As long as whatever they're lifting and moving, there's a mechanical aid out there. Now, let's be creative. Make the mechanical aid do the work and not our bodies. Efficiency, I'm going to leave this slide in here. You can, helps for the set the tone for the company safety culture. Yeah, you're right. You're right, David. Appreciate you putting that in there. So I'm not going to talk a whole lot about this, but I do want us to know that when we are struggling to lift and move and do things in these jobs, it does affect efficiency. It does wear our employees out. It does slow them down. The more we touch a product, the more inefficient we get. So remember return on investment. Remember post-offer employment testing. Remember the best practices of managing a work comp claim to include light duty and things of that nature and company direct medical, but also remember efficiency. Okay. So when we handle more heavy things, it is more inefficient for our company. If we can find some equipment and gear and engineering tools to help us make that safer, we're going to be a lot better off. It's 12:57. I'm going to wrap up. You know, I can't say thank you enough. I really appreciate everybody joining us today. We love doing the webinars because folks can come in from all over the place and listen in. We record these. This will be put out on the website on our webinars homepage. So you will see this recording again. Let me know what you think about the webinar. Let me know what you thought about the content today. I hope it was helpful. Orthopedic injury prevention can go from anywhere from desks to heavy manufacturing to construction. So it's really a broad topic. If anybody would like additional training on this, or if you want us to provide a training session for your company, just call. That's my contact info. You can reach out anytime.